I have to be careful what I say. Okay, so welcome everyone to this course on asymptotic symmetries, black holes, and holography. So I thought I would spend the first 15 minutes or so just telling you roughly what the course will be about, and also how these subjects relate to each other. For all the administrative information, please refer to Ricardo, who has done a great job organizing this. Okay, so let me start with the asymptotic symmetries. So what are asymptotic symmetries? To understand this, it's good to remember what's a global symmetry. And you might remember that every time that you have a continuous global symmetry, there's associated neutral current. Current d mu, which is conserved motion, and that can subsequently be used to construct a conserved charge. So q, which is just the integral over some space like slice of the zero component of the current, d minus 1x, so I mean d space time dimensions. And okay, let me just here. So the reason that the charge is conserved is so you can imagine that your space time looks something like this, with time running upwards. The slice sigma is this one. And to show charge conservation, you have to compute the difference between the two charges evaluated on the surface sigma here and the surface sigma prime at the subsequent time. And because the current is conserved, so the bulk part, d mu j mu is equal to zero, you know that the surface integral of the normal component of the current has to vanish. So the difference between these two is just the integral of the normal of the current over this little band over here. And if you assume that j perpendicular is this guy, is zero, then you show that the charge is conserved. So this is just the usual conservation law for global symmetries. This charge is conserved if there's no flux passing through the boundary of the space. Now, I should say that this neutral current is not unique. So if you have some conserved neutral current J mu, you can define a new neutral current J mu tilde to where you add to J mu the divergence of a two-index object, which is antisymmetric. So you see that if you take the divergence of this thing, it's going to be the same as the divergence of this guy, because this time this is zero. So there's a small ambiguity in what the neutral current is. And you're probably familiar with this ambiguity. For example, this ambiguity can be useful. For example, if you try to compute the stress tensor. So that's the neutral current associated to translations. The canonical one is not gauge invariant. But then you make precisely use of this ambiguity through the Bellingfalde procedure to get the gauge invariant stress tensor. And I should say, okay, so throughout this lecture, we're going to be making a lot of use of form notation. So I can define, I can also write this neutral current as a d minus 1 form by just contracting this guy with the epsilon tensor. Okay, so I have one index, contracting the epsilon tensor, I have a d minus 1 form. So in form notation, this equation looks like this. Okay. So then I see that in principle this ambiguity k can contribute to the so the integral of j tilde will be the same as the integral of j, but this k can give a contribution only if it's non-vanishing on the boundary of the surface. So this is the general story for global currents. Now, what if we have a gauge symmetry? So the reason I put it in quotes is that, of course, gauge symmetries are not true symmetries of the theory, but rather are redundancies of description. So what you find when you do this is that actually the bulk part of the neutral current, the usual neutral current, is zero, identically on shadow. So basically, the neutral current itself is equal to something, which is just zero on shell, plus this decay. So if you want to have at all a non-trivial conserved charge, so given that this part is zero, then the charge, which is the integral of J over this sigma, only picks a contribution from this guy K from the boundary of sigma. Are people familiar with the form notation? Okay. So you see that if you have a gauge theory, the only way to get a non-trivial conserved charge is if this contribution K, the boundary contribution, is non-zero. So what this means, so this K, of course, depends on the gauge parameter epsilon. What this means is that if you have a gauge symmetry, where the gauge parameter is just non-zero somewhere in the middle of the spacetime, but it goes to zero at infinity, you're not going to get any contribution to the conserved charge. Whereas if you have a gauge symmetry where the gauge parameter is non-zero at infinity, then this charge can be non-zero. So that's basically the principle behind asymptotic symmetries. In gauge theories, the gauge transformations, because most of them are unphysical, so small gauge transformations, the one that vanish at infinity, they don't lead to any non-trivial conserved charges. And that's normal because these are not physical symmetries. However, gauge parameters that do not vanish at infinity can lead to non-trivial conserved charges. And they actually correspond to actual physical symmetries, obviously. So this is an asymptotic symmetry. And in order for this charge, so you ideally want this charge to be conserved. And you see that the charge will be conserved. So if you compute the difference between two charges evaluated on the boundary of this sigma prime on the boundary of sigma, you see that they're just going to, the difference is going to be the integral of decay over this boundary in here, which unfortunately you cannot see very well. So Q is conserved. So basically, so this is basically what I want to say. This is the definition of asymptotic symmetry. They are engaged theories, they're gauge parameters that fall off slowly enough at infinity to lead to non-trivial conserved charges, and thus are true symmetry. Okay. So this was this part. Now let me talk a little bit about holography. So what is holography? The statement of holography is that you have that if you have a theory of quantum gravity on some manifold M, this is equivalent to a theory without gravity, which I'm going to call the field theory, which just lives on the boundary of your manifold M. So this is the statement. This is an incredibly non-trivial statement about the behavior of quantum gravity. So for example, it tells you that if you have gravity in five dimensions, that can be entirely rewritten as a four-dimensional theory, which looks a bit like quantum thermodynamics. So it's a very non-trivial statement. It's also quite important to try to find what this field theory dual to quantum gravity on your background manifold of choice is. Because, as you might know, quantizing gravity is a very difficult subject, and it's also full of problems and paradoxes, such as the black hole information paradox. However, if you manage to write this gravitational theory, to rewrite it in terms of the field theory on this boundary, the field theory is just the usual quantum mechanical theory, which is free of paradoxes. So this is why it's interesting to try to find this sort of holographic map between the theory of quantum gravity on some manifold and the field theory on the boundary. Because basically, the field theory is the quantum theory of gravity, so without paradoxes. So we're interested in it. Of course, then you have to understand how you recover back the space-time description from the field theory, but that's another story. People are confused. If you have questions, please ask me. Okay. Now, what's nice about this holographic correspondence is that it's universal. So the type of field theory that you get only depends on the asymptotic structure of the space-time manifold M, and not on the particular details of your gravitational theory. So if you change the spectrum a little bit, you're just going to change a little bit the spectrum of the field theory, but you're not going to change the type of field theory that you have. So a very famous example of this is the ADHD plus 1 CFTP correspondence. So here the correspondence is between a theory of quantum gravity on a so-called anti-de Sitter spacetime in D plus one dimension. So this is a very nice spacetime. It's hyperbolic, so it has constant negative curvature. And whatever theory of quantum gravity you put on such a spacetime, you're always going to have a conformal field theory living on the boundary of ADS. So this is a very well-studied example. However, the problem is that this works very nicely and has been very heavily checked. The problem is that if you try to find some other spacetimes of interest where you want to know what quantum gravity on them is, it's much harder. So for example, if you want to know what quantum gravity on flat space gives you on the boundary, the answer is that we don't know. So this is where the asymptotic symmetries come in. Because you see, this sort of holographic setup is a very natural setup for asymptotic symmetries. Because, as I said, asymptotic symmetries are discussed in the context of gauge theories. So, of course, gravity is a gauge theory. And so we get that the asymptotic symmetries of this theory of quantum gravity on N are just going to become so which live at the boundary on N, are going to be just the global symmetries of the dual field theory. Okay? So if we want to find what this field theory could possibly be, one very good idea is to just try to study the asymptotic symmetries of quantum gravity here. And, you know, if we're lucky enough, we might find that there's an infinite number of asymptotic symmetries. And these asymptotic symmetries might have an interesting algebra. So usually the asymptotic symmetries form a group, and you can compute the group action and structure constants and so on. So if you find some sort of interesting structure there, you might try to guess, or at least put some heavy constraints on what the possible field theory living on the boundary. So that's usually the game, and this is why these guys are useful. And so in this course, okay, so let me just give a bunch of examples. So I'll start with the boring example, which is just ADS-CFT. So in ADS-CFT, ADS plus 1-CFT, you have two cases. If D is greater than 2, then the asymptotic symmetry group is boring. It's just the, so ASG stands for asymptotic symmetry group. The asymptotic symmetry group is just conformal group in D dimensions, which is SO D, 2. And this is very well known. This is the first check that we do of the ADS-CFT correspondence is to match the symmetries, and indeed they match. I should make a little, technical, obnoxious statement. Usually people match the symmetries of the CFT to the isometries of the vacuum ADS solution. Technically speaking, that's not what you should do. Technically speaking, you should be matching the symmetries of the CFT with the asymptotic symmetries of ADS, which for D greater than 2 happen to coincide with the isometries of the vacuum. So asymptotic symmetries are for general spacetimes where you can do something non-trivial in the middle of ADS, whereas isometries of the vacuum, I mean, you're stuck in the vacuum. They're not quite the same. And you can see they're not quite the same if you do the case D equal to 2. So this is ADS-3 CFT2, where some of you may well know that the global conformal group in two dimensions gets an infinite dimensional extension, which is Virasoro times Virasoro. And the way that you see this infinite dimensional symmetries in space-time is precisely through an asymptotic symmetry analysis. So they're no longer isometries of the vacuum space-time because there are too many of them, but you see them as asymptotic symmetries of the distribution. Okay, so this is one a very well-known example. So actually this case was studied well before IPhT-TV by Brown and Nano. Of course, didn't make the conjecture that quantum gravity in ADS3 is dual to two-dimensional conformal field theory. You need some reasons to believe that. So this is nice, but we already knew about the ADS-CFT correspondence. So can we get something new from these asymptotic symmetries? So one new thing that you can get is by looking at extremal black holes. So it turns out that extremal black holes, so say they're asymptotically flat. So these are maximally spinning black holes. And when the angular momentum reaches its maximum values, actually the black hole geometry starts developing a very, very long throat. And here where is the horizon? So you have to enter this throat region, which has some additional symmetries. And what you can do, so it turns out that the dynamics of the modes that sort of are in the asymptotic region decouples from the dynamic of the modes in the throat. So you can just chop off the throat and just consider this part of the spacetime. And then if you do an asymptotic symmetry group analysis of this chopped off spacetime, what you find is that you again find an infinite dimensional Virasoro algebra. And what's interesting about this one is that here you had no clue from string theory or from any other methods. So the fact that you find the Virasoro algebra leads you to think that maybe you have a two-dimensional CFT that describes the space-time holographically. And in this case, there was no hint from string theory or from anywhere else that this should be the case. So this is one application which is interesting. Another application that's interesting, if you consider flat space. Okay, so this is Penrose's diagram for flat space. I'm going to explain what it is later. But it turns out that if you look at the asymptotic symmetries at what is known as non-infinity, so somewhere here, you again find an infinite dimensional symmetry group, which is known as Bondi, Van der Burg, Metzner, and Sachs asymptotic symmetry group, which is again infinite dimensional. So that's quite interesting. In this case, so far, there's not really any holographic proposal for flat space. I mean, there are some sort of interesting indications, but no one has made a precise proposal. But it turns out that this infinite dimensional symmetry group has some very interesting relations to what are known as soft theorems. So this is, as I said, I won't discuss holography for this guy, but it turns out that if you try to study gravity, like scattering in gravity on flat space, the consequences of this infinite dimensional asymptotic symmetry group can be rederived in a completely Feynman diagrammatic language through what is known as soft theorems. So there's a nice equivalence that was discussed recently by Strominger and then a lot of people. It also tells you something that was a bit surprising, which is that the vacuum of general relativity is infinitely degenerate. And the reason is that all of these BMS symmetries, actually, they don't carry any energies. They commute to the Hamiltonian. So you have a lot of different space-time with different charges, but all of which have zero energy. So that tells you that the vacuum is degenerate, which is another interesting finding. Okay, good. So much for holography and relation to asymptotic symmetries. Now let me talk a little bit about black holes. And the short for black holes is going to be BH. So black holes, actually I won't really be talking anything in particular about black holes in this course, but I should say that really the backdrop against which everything else is based. So they're very important. They're sort of in the background, but they're really, really important. So one reason that they're really important is because, holography, this whole non-trivial statement, comes from the study of black holes. And in particular, it comes from the study of the so-called laws of black hole mechanics. What these laws say is that if you have a process where you say you throw something inside the black hole, you notice, so suppose that the change in the area of the horizon of the black hole multiplied by the surface gravity of the black hole, so the analogous of little g for us, is the change in mass of the black hole. And also, you have that the area of the horizon always increases. If you stare at these laws enough, you see a striking similarity with the laws of thermodynamics. If you conjecture that if you assign the black holes an entropy that is proportional to the area of the horizon. You see? And this guy should be the temperature. Speaking, so TDS, CDM, this is how high energy theorists write the first law of black hole mechanics, and delta S is always positive. And you see that the fact that the entropy is proportional to the area as opposed to the volume is basically the essence of holography, that you have something which is in D plus one dimension, it's equivalent with something in D dimension. So this is where it all comes from. Another reason for which black holes will be important is that many holographic dualities come in near horizon decoupling limits of black holes or black brains. It's true of IPhT, it's true of this guy. So they're also important in that way. And finally, they allow for very nice checks of holography. So one of the holy grails of checking holography is to try to reproduce this relation with all the correct factors, which are 1/4. So black holes are very useful for that too. Okay, so this is pretty much where black holes will come in. And the plan of the course I can tell you what the plan is. So first, I'm going to start by discussing this asymptotic symmetry business. To discuss asymptotic symmetries, you need a formalism. And the formalism that I'll use is called the covariant phase space formalism, which is, like any formalism, it's a bit heavy. But the great advantage of it is that it's incredibly powerful. So if it doesn't work within 2 minutes, I'll write the plan here. Okay, so first I'll talk about formalism. So I should say that, so what's nice about this formalism is that it is very, very powerful. So it works, it works in spacetimes. Okay, thank you very much. Can you make it full screen?
You.
I can make the full screen. So what's nice about this formalism is that you can adapt it to pretty much any crazy spacetime that you want. So if you have a spacetime with a very strange asymptotic structure, usually this formalism works where other formalisms may fail. So it's a very useful piece of formalism to know. I should say that I'll just try to go through the main derivation of it. Once you understand how it's derived, you can find all the formulae in the literature. And in particular, I should say that there's some. So recently, Geoffrey Compere gave a set of lectures at the Paris, Brussels, Amsterdam school, which actually are going to have a lot of overlap to what I'm talking about. And so you can find a lot of details. Like, if you want more detailed stuff, you can find it in his notes, which are typed, and everything is very nice. He's also one of the people who developed the formalism. Okay, so so if you manage to stay awake while I talk about this, I decided that maybe I should give you some bonus for having listened. So it turns out this formalism can be used to derive certain known facts in a very nice and slick way. So for example, you can get a one-line derivation of the first law of black hole mechanics, which is this guy. And not only that, but you can also very naturally get a generalization of the black hole entropy of this relation if you have higher derivative corrections. So if you don't just have Einstein gravity in the bulk, but if you have some R squared terms and so on, then this entropy gets corrected, and this formalism just spits out a formula that works perfectly and matches with everything that we know that we can check in string theory. So it's a very useful piece of stuff to know. And then time permitting, so depending how much introduction I need to do, I might also talk about the converse of the first law. So the converse of this first law of black hole mechanics, you can prove it if you use Einstein's equations. So the converse consists of assuming the first law and trying to derive Einstein's equations from it. And in that case, it turns out that it's better to talk about entanglement entropy rather than black hole entropy. So if I have time, I'll discuss that. So these are some applications of the formalism to black holes and to holography. And then I'll talk about asymptotic symmetries, so giving you these examples of spacetimes. So first I'll talk about the well-known work about asymptotic symmetries of ADS3. You can do some very simple-minded holography just knowing the asymptotic symmetries and some properties of black holes in the spacetimes. So I'll show you how that works. And then I'll take these ideas and talk about this spacetime, so compute its asymptotic symmetries and try to see what these Virasoro symmetries mean and so on. Finally, I'll talk about this other infinite dimensional asymptotic symmetry group, which is the BMS group for asymptotically flat space in four dimensions. And so there the plan is, so first I'll talk about the asymptotic structure, explain where this diamond comes from. Then I'll talk about asymptotic symmetries, which are super translations and super rotations. It turns out that these symmetries have a nice physical measurable effect, which is called the gravitational memory effect. So I'll talk about that too. Then I'll show you. So it turns out that these BMS symmetries are actually symmetries of flat space scattering. And that you can do if you can connect the symmetries on past non-infinity to future non-infinity, and that involves understanding this kind of subtle corner of the diagram, and then that was done by Strominger, so I'll talk about that too, and how you get a new set of conservation laws. Then I'll discuss relation to soft theorems. And then, time permitting, so it turns out that because these BMS symmetries have zero energy, you can have, hair on the black hole horizon. So this has some sort of bearing on the information paradox. So this was argued by Hawking, Perry, and Strominger recently, that maybe one has to think a little bit differently about the information paradox if you consider this hair. So time permitting, I'll also discuss that a little bit. Okay, so this is the plan. Are there any questions?
you can erase it.
Ah, okay. As I said today, I'll talk about this this covariant phase space formalism. So this was developed, I guess, in the early 90s by Wald and collaborators, and then picked up by the Belgian group, published Kant, Eno, and then compare. And basically, it's just a follow up to Noether's ideas. So what you know about Noether currents for the case of global symmetries, we just transpose this to local symmetries. Okay, so let me start by just reminding you how the Noether derivation works for just the global symmetry. So for a global symmetry, you have some symmetry parameter epsilon, which is constant. And there are two ways to derive the Noether current. One slick way is to say, okay, so because this is a symmetry of the action for epsilon constant, delta epsilon equals constant over S is zero. And now imagine that instead of considering epsilon constant, you send epsilon to be a function of the spacetime coordinates. Then the action is no longer invariant, so you have delta epsilon of x s, but it has to vanish for epsilon constant, so the action has to be proportional to d mu epsilon of x times something. And let's call this something J mu. Okay? So this was completely, this is off shell. Now, if you go on shell, then you know that infinitesimal variations of the action are zero. So this guy has to be zero. So suppose that you take an epsilon of x, which sort of vanishes at infinity. So you can integrate this by parts. You don't pick any boundary term because this guy has compact support. So let's take epsilon with compact support. Then what you find is that integral of epsilon of x equal to zero, still on shell. And since this is true for arbitrary epsilon of x, you deduce that the divergence of the current has to be zero. Okay? So this is the simplest way that there is a current. And you know, if you want, you can actually take the action. So take a simple example like d mu phi, d mu phi star, and consider rotation phi is e to the I epsilon phi, things like that. And you make epsilon of x, expand the action, find that the first term is zero, and then you pick out J mu from this. It's done in some books. I forgot to maintain either Peskin and Schroeder or Weinberg does it this way. A more practical way or the way that we're usually used to getting the actual expression for the Noether current is the following. You consider an arbitrary variation of the action. Under an arbitrary variation of the action. So by the way, phi are going to be denoting all the fields in the theory, no matter what they are. So this is going to be an integral of the equations of motion, depend on phi, times d phi, plus an eventual boundary term. which I'm going to call theta. So this is, well, you know this very well. So if you take the Lagrangian to be, well, some general Lagrangian of Q and, okay, let's take L is Q dot squared. In order to get the equation of motion for Q, you need to integrate by parts, right? When you take delta of this guy, you're going to have a delta Q dot, which you need to integrate by parts in order to get the equations of motion. So you're going to pick up a term. Should I do this? Okay. And now, okay, so this is for an arbitrary variation of the action. But now, okay, if I consider the variation of the action, okay, so this is one point. The second point is that if I consider the variation of the action under this epsilon, which is constant, the action is invariant, but the Lagrangian itself might not be. So the Lagrangian might vary by a total derivative, which is consistent with the action being invariant. So you might get a boundary term d mu and mu. Okay. So just to give you an example. So if you consider, for example, a space-time translation, x mu goes to x mu plus some constant a mu, then this boundary term m mu is a mu times the Lagrangian. Okay, so sometimes you get this, sometimes you don't. For this symmetry, for example, you don't get this. Okay, so now you can construct so now if you define the current J mu, which is theta mu, at the variation of the fields with respect to epsilon minus epsilon, then you find that this current is conserved on shell, because basically you equate these two guys. You set delta to be delta of epsilon here, so you see that the J mu is going to be minus the equations of motion times delta epsilon. So this is zero. Okay. And note that this also gives you a very concrete way to construct the Noether current. Because once you know the Lagrangian, you know all the boundary terms that you get when you try to move stuff around to construct your equations of motion. And this you just get it from the variation boundary terms that you get in the variation of the Lagrangian under the symmetry. So this is the. As I said before, this Noether current is a little bit ambiguous. Sometimes you want to improve it by adding this K mu term to it. Okay. So I thought since this is a course, so there are no students really taking this course.
The audience.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. So for whoever feels like a student, maybe no one. Here is an exercise.
Okay, we have a student.
You're a student. Okay, so you have to do this. No, sorry, I'm joking. So for example, if you just want to play with this, so take this Lagrangian and calculate J mu. By the way, these are written in the, they will be in the lecture notes, so you don't need to copy them now, if you're actually planning to do them. The exercise is to calculate J mu for the symmetries. Phi goes to e to the I epsilon phi, and the translation symmetry is x mu goes to epsilon plus m. So this should work. Okay, good. So this is the usual story with the Noether current for global symmetries. So now let's talk about local symmetries. So now the difference is that the symmetry parameter is a function of the space-time coordinates. So the variation of the action with an arbitrary epsilon of x is zero of shell. Okay, so it turns out that Noether also wrote a theorem for this case. It's called Noether's second theorem. Okay, so let's see what happens. So we compute delta epsilon of x of the action, and just as before, we get an integral of the equivalence of motion times delta epsilon of phi plus d mu theta mu of delta epsilon of phi, just as before. And now it is useful to make some assumption or just take a specific form for what the variation of the fields phi are. So I will restrict myself to the case where the variation of the fields, okay, let me write it here, takes the form some function of phi times epsilon of x plus some other function with an index mu times v mu epsilon of x. So in principle, you can consider arbitrary derivatives of this epsilon appearing, but for most cases of interest, you don't need to. So for example, so now let's suppose that I consider this symmetry here. So I make the parameter epsilon of x. So you see that the variation of the field phi is linear in epsilon, so it has no derivatives. And of course, when I gauge the theory, I need to introduce a gauge field. The gauge field will shift by something proportional to d mu epsilon, and that's it. And yeah.
Sorry, does f of phi can be a derivative?
I mean, it can depend arbitrarily on the fields. But here, what's important is that you have no higher than linear derivatives on epsilon. Okay. So yeah. So same for gravity. The graviton transforms with derivatives of the diffeomorphisms and nothing more. So this is all we need to consider. And so if you take this into account, and suppose let's take for now epsilon with compact support.
So Monica, I have a question.
Yeah.
This has to do with the fact that the equations of motion are second order. The fact, why is the case that we get only up to first derivative on epsilon in all cases that we care about? I mean, is there something deeper or just...
You're saying that if I had some sort of crazy derivative on a scalar field with that sort of... I need to introduce gauge fields that...
And maybe I have a lot of, the gauge transformation, a lot of derivatives.
I don't know of any case, of any example where you need higher derivatives. Because in general, you just make all the derivatives covariant, so you can have as many covariant derivatives as you want, acting on phi, and you still need just the gauge field in the nominal. So, yeah. Compact support. Okay, so now let me assume that this parameter epsilon has compact support, so it vanishes at infinity, so I can forget about this term. And I write this as integral, so let me plug in epsilon of phi and plug in that thing. So it's f of phi epsilon of x plus f mu epsilon of x. And now I can integrate this term by parts and drop the total derivative because this guy vanishes at infinity. So what I get is integral of the equivalence of motion into f of phi minus equivalence of motion into f of phi minus d mu epsilon d mu f mu f mu d mu epsilon. Okay. because this f mu is supposed to be constant. Okay, okay, so let me just do this. Okay, so in my notes I had this f mu pulled out, and I guess there was an extra assumption that these were just a bunch of constants. It's oftentimes true, like, you know, for a gauge field you have delta mu is minus d mu epsilon with nothing else, but anyways. the point is the following. The point is that, you see, this combination. So you have a combination of the equivalence of motion into these functions that define your transformation law, whose integral into an arbitrary epsilon has to be identically zero of shape. So from this, you conclude that this whole thing, this whole combination of the equivalence of motion has to be zero. has to be zero. So there's basically a relation between the equations of motion in the theory, which is, how to say, it's a normal feature of gauge theories that you get some constraints. So this is how you see it in this sort of Lagrangian form.
That's for any function f, or?
Hmm?
That's for any function f?
No. F are the particular functions that appear in the transformation laws for your fields. So for example, for this case, so let's do phi. So if I consider a complex scalar coupled to a gauge field, I have delta phi equals I epsilon phi, and delta I mu is this. Okay, so you read f and f mu, and you see here there are different fields that appear, so you have to sum over all of this. Once you know the transformation law, this particular combination of equations of motion has to vanish just identically. Okay, what this means is now if I take this term, so if I just take the equations of motion times delta epsilon phi, is that this has to. So for some reason in my notes I had this f mu constant, so I'm just going to pull it out. So this has to equal epsilon of x times f of phi into the equations of motion minus f mu of the equations of motion. And remember, because we took epsilon with compact support, we throw away all boundary terms. But this is supposed to be an identity. So when I have the equations of motion into this, it's going to be this sort of bulk term up to, it's going to be this term up to some boundary terms. So I'm going to write these boundary terms as the divergence of some current S mu. And this current only depends on the equations of motion, because what I'm writing is some and on the symmetry. Because what I'm writing is this is just a rewriting of the equations of motion. So this is called the Noether identity. Identities, because there are several of them. And basically what you get from here is that that the equations of motion are some term I guess what I want to say is that you can just rewrite the equations of motion in this form, where this S mu vanishes on shell because it's been constructed purely from the equations of motion. Okay, so now what we want to do is basically find the relation between this. This is called the on-shell vanishing Noether current. And the usual Noether current defined like that, which I can still define even when I have a local symmetry. Okay, so just to repeat, okay, this was a little bit formal, but the main idea is that whenever you have a local symmetry, so the variation of the action has to be zero off shell for arbitrary epsilon of x, you can derive these particular constraints that the equations of motion, relations that the equations of motion have to satisfy, just a consequence of the local symmetry, and you can rewrite the equations of motion into the variation, into this form, plus some current S mu, which vanishes identically.
Okay. So, can you give an example, like in QED, what would be S mu?
Yeah, very good. I can do an example. Can I erase this part? If article, because that part is slightly more useful. Okay, so let's do just Maxwell. So minus force dx f mu nu. F mu nu. So we have a nu going to a nu plus mu epsilon. Okay, so when you compute the variation of the action with respect to this epsilon of x, well, what you find is minus a force dx. Well, and then you're going to pick up a 4. You're going to pick up a 2 by just the f squared, and another 2 because this guy is anti-symmetrized in A. So what you're going to pick up is f mu nu d nu delta a nu. And now we move. Let's see what we do. So now we have to move this d mu onto f to get the equations of motion. So this I can write as integral d mu f mu nu delta a nu minus d nu, f nu, delta n nu, and I have to put epsilons all over the place. Okay, so now I want to look at this term. Okay, so what did I do? Okay, so. This was the term that involves the equations of motion, so what I was writing e to the e of phi delta epsilon phi. And this is the term, which is very good, which is d mu theta mu. Okay? So now we want to massage this term to show that it looks like okay. Now we want to massage that term. So d nu f mu nu delta epsilon a nu is so this is just the equation of motion. Let me just write it like e nu d nu epsilon, where I plugged in the variation of the gauge field.
Should that term be minus? Shouldn't the signs be? That term be minus and that term be plus.
Oh, I'm not very careful about signs. I mean, sorry.
Yeah, there's a minus in front.
Because I put the minus here.
There's a minus in front.
Right. Okay. Very good. Thank you. Okay. But now we're trying to do this manipulation. So okay. So now I can integrate this by parts. So I can put d nu of e nu epsilon of x here and subtract epsilon of x d nu e nu. Okay? So you see, Okay, so what was the equation of motion? The equation of motion is just d mu f mu nu. So this is d mu of d mu f mu nu, which is identically zero off shell, because f mu nu is anti-symmetric. So this is basically the Noether identity. And according to our definition that I just erased, this guy should be the on-shell vanishing Noether current. And you see that it's proportional to the equation of motion. So the on-shell vanishing Noether current for ENM is just d mu f mu times epsilon. So it very obviously vanishes on shell. Okay, good. So thank you, Brando, for asking for an example, because then I can also do an example for the full Noether current. So now we have this guy.
There shouldn't be an epsilon in the definition of the current. Sorry? You need an epsilon there, why?
Because this is what it is. So I define the current by taking the equations of motion into the variation of the fields and playing with them, splitting them into a term that just vanishes identically.
Usually currents are not depending on epsilon. You choose some epsilon and then...
When epsilon is constant, you can drop it. But when it's not constant, you don't drop it.
I mean, there are infinitely many currents. You do it.
Yeah.
You know, Taylor series of epsilon, running constant.
So in the end, so for example, for BMS, we're going to be allowing for non-constant epsilon of x. So that will indeed give rise to, this is not this is not the current that's giving us the charge, because the current, we need a 2-degree form to really get the constant charge, but this is a part of the derivation. Okay, so the point of the exercise was to show what I had claimed at the beginning of the lecture, that in gauge theory, so when we have local symmetries, the bulk part of the Noether current just vanishes identically on shell. So here you see that this current, S nu, is conserved. And similarly, the usual Noether current, this J mu defined here, is also conserved. So the idea, and maybe I should write this, that the Noether current defined the usual way as upstairs is going to be, let me just get the sign right, do I want pluses or minuses, just a second, so I want to write this, S mu is minus J mu, minus B mu. Okay, so we just saw that there's this completely on-shell vanishing Noether current that's conserved on-shell. We also have the usual Noether current that's conserved on-shell. Logically, these two currents must differ only by a divergence of a two-index object, which is anti-symmetric in these two indices. So I'm going to mark it like this. And this goes back to what I was saying at the beginning of the lecture, is that if you want to compute conserved charges in this theory, you can integrate your Noether current, but on shell, so the bulk contribution to that Noether current is going to be zero, because this S mu is zero, identically on shell, but you can have a boundary contribution, which comes from this Q mu nu. And let's try to get an expression for this Q. Okay, so maybe it's a good exercise to still keep in this Maxwell theory and try to compute what J mu and Q mu nu are. Okay. Good. So to define J mu, we need this theta term, which was just the integration, the total derivative that I get when I try to derive the equivalence of motion. So theta mu is just minus f mu delta m mu. And m mu is just zero because m mu was defined as the total derivative terms that I might pick up when I consider the variation of the action, but you see that the Lagrangian itself is gauge invariant, so I don't pick up any boundary terms. So this guy is zero, so this is actually equal to j mu, j mu is theta mu for delta epsilon, so let me write. J mu is minus f mu mu delta epsilon of a mu, so it's just minus f mu mu d mu epsilon. Okay, so now I should check that J mu is indeed the on-shell vanishing Noether current up to some total derivative like this. And indeed, I can see that. So J mu is minus F mu mu D mu epsilon equals minus D mu epsilon of X F mu plus epsilon of X D mu F mu. Okay, so up to science. Up to science, you see that what I've gotten here is precisely this. So this is the ocean vanishing Noether current. I actually, without science, because it's actually correct, because I switched the indices. So this is minus S mu. You can compare. And then I get a total derivative term, a total derivative of a two-index object that's anti-symmetric. So this should be Q mu. And then the charge, the conserved charge, was the integral over the boundary of the spacetime. So remember, we had this sort of spacetime drawn as a cylinder, and we had some space like slice sigma, and the charge only reduced to a contribution that came from the boundary of sigma, which I write like this, which is this part over here. So the charge is the integral over the boundary of sigma of this Q mu. And this is nothing but epsilon of x. And now I have to put in some, I have to go to form notation. So I need to dot this guy into an epsilon tensor. So I get epsilon alpha beta mu nu into f mu. Okay. And this is just, for epsilon constant, this is just the usual definition of electric charge. You integrate the electric field over the sphere at infinity. But you know, in principle, if you can allow for more general epsilon of x, this will give you a generalization of electric charge. Okay, so this is how this formalism sort of reproduces what you know. But I have to go a little bit further and introduce a little bit more. Complication just to get to the general construction of conserved charges in various spacetimes. But was it clear more or less what it does?
Pause.
Okay, it's a good time to pause, and then we're going to continue with the rest of the formats. So now I'll switch to some fancy form. Out of my own laziness, I'm going to switch to fancy form notation. So instead of J mu, okay, so maybe I can write down. So J, which was a vector before, is going to become a T minus 1 form, which is going to be 1 over this D minus 1 factorial. By the way, if you want the hopefully correct conventions, I just redirected to Geoffrey's notes, Geoffrey Comper's notes. And he's worked out all of this in detail. And minus one small typo that I found, I think they're correct. So I'm going to have this form J, which is epsilon mu 1 for mu d minus 1 alpha j alpha times dx mu 1 which blah blah. And so on. So the form Q, similarly, so I think I'm going to have a half times d minus 2 factorial, similar epsilon. So Q, okay, so this relation is going to become S is minus J, d minus 1 form, d minus 1 form, minus dQ, who is a d minus 2 form. So it's the same deal, d minus 2, alpha, beta, 2 alpha, beta, is all the dxs, and so on.
The forms are not. E of a 2 form is a 3 form.
So Q is a d minus 2 form, d
but
over
two
d minus 2 form is a d minus 1 form. And the Lagrangian itself is going to become a d form. So it's just going to be 1 over this d factorial. So mu 1, mu d, L, dx, mu 1. Okay. So now we're going to be very fancy. So then I can just rewrite all my previous equations in form notation. So delta L is the equivalence of motion, which are going to be d forms now. So I just multiply them by epsilon, basically. D phi plus d theta of delta phi. So this was the boundary term that I was getting when varying the Lagrangian to get the equivalence of motion. And actually, this guy has a name. I mean, had a name before, but it's called the presymplectic. Potential. Then I said that under a variation under the symmetry epsilon of x, the Lagrangian could go into a total derivative, which I called m. So this is dm epsilon. And the gauge symmetries we'll consider are either the usual gauge symmetries or diffeomorphisms for gravity. So this m is only non-zero. So in gravity, this m, so for diffeomorphism C is just C dot L. So what this notation means is that I contract the mu index of the diffeomorphism. So diffeomorphism is a vector, so it has an index mu. And what this notation means is that I contract this epsilon, this xi mu, with one of the mu's of this epsilon here. Okay, so I lose one index, so I end up with a d minus 1 form, and this m is a d minus 1 form. All of this, I should say, all of this can be done in usual notation. It's just much longer. But this is more of a proof of principle formalism. At the end, it's just going to spit out some expression for the charges, which you can read in the literature and, you know, plug them into mathematics and compute stuff. So, but I just wanted to show where things come from. So, okay. Good. And For gauge symmetries, actually, I'm going to take m to be 0. You only get non-zero m for gauge symmetries if you have transcendence terms in your Lagrangian. And there are expressions for them in the literature, but I'm not going to bother with them. So I'll take m lambda to be 0 for simplicity. Good. So now, the Noether current, this is j epsilon of phi. By the definition that was up there, is just theta of delta epsilon of phi minus. Okay, so now maybe let me just work with diffeomorphisms, but sometimes I can also talk about this. Okay, so I'll fix diffeomorphisms, and I'm going to have this m, which is xi dot L, right? Just plugging in the explicit expression for M mu. And we also have the definition of this on-shell vanishing Noether current, which is that the equivalence of motion into Dirac C phi is dlc of the equivalence of motion. And by equating these two as before, we see that this is also equal to minus djc. This is what we were doing before. So we conclude, we conclude this relation, which is that, maybe I should write that here, S xi of the equation of motion of phi is minus j xi phi minus v q xi of phi. And this is a completely off-shell relation. And as I said, if we want to compute the conserved charges, on-shell, so S is going to be 0, we just integrate this J over sigma, which is just going to pick up a contribution from this Q from the sigma. So the conserved charge, as I said, is going to be the integral. It's something like the integral of Q. So Q is, from this relation, you see that Q is a D minus 2 form. So it makes sense to integrate it over the boundary of the surface sigma. So sigma is codimension 1, and this sigma is codimension 2. So I integrate a D minus 2 form over D minus 2 surface. OK, so. Very good, using the Noether identities. Very good, thank you. So we use the Noether identities, which tell you that part that you're talking about vanishes, and as you saw, that was basically the Bianchi identity for. So this thing, I should say, this Noether identity for gravity is just going to be the fact that the divergence of the Einstein tensor is 0. So it's something structural that has nothing to do with the dynamics of your theory. So very good. So here you use the Noether identities to cancel off that term. So you're just left with the divergence of the on-shell vanishing Noether.
Is it possible that the d minus 1 Dirac cohomology of the spacetime is non-trivial, that the s plus j cannot be written in terms of
right.
D.
So we basically never considered that. Yeah, in principle that could happen, but we're never going to consider that. So we can write this. So we only deal with electric charge first. Good. So you see this Q? Okay, so remember, so the way that we're constructing the Noether charge was to integrate this Q over the boundary of the spacetime. And we really want this charge to be conserved. So in order for the charge, maybe I should use some color chalk. So if we want the charge to be conserved, we should evaluate this Q on the boundary of some later surface sigma prime and make sure that the two results agree. Now, so let me write, so Q at T prime. Okay. So let me say that this is just time. Okay, so the difference between the charge evaluated here minus the charge evaluated here is just going to be the integral over basically this surface over here. So I can think of these two circles, the sigma and the sigma prime, as bounding some sort of, some sort of band region like this over here, which I tried to color in orange. Okay. So these are the boundaries of this region. So the difference between these two guys is going to be the integral over the, let me call this region B, of dq. Okay? So the integral of dq over this region B equals the integral of q over the boundary of region B, which turns out to be nothing but the difference of the concentration. So you see, if you want this charge q to be conserved, you should better have automatically that dq is zero. And this is a bit non-trivial because you see, the entire contribution to Q comes from a boundary term. So you need the charge to be non-zero, but you need the Q to be zero. So we need to ensure that somehow. Okay, so the way that we're gonna, and the problem is that from this relation, I mean, on shell S is going to be zero, but from this relation it's not terribly obvious that the Q is going to be zero at the boundary. So we need to do something about that. And what is usually done is to consider the variation of the charge between two backgrounds, one which has some background fields phi, and the other one which has some background fields phi plus delta phi. In that case, it would be much more obvious what definition of the charge would satisfy this sort of relation that the q equals to zero at the boundary. Okay. So I'll try to explain that. So we want to consider two backgrounds. So let me see what I need. Okay, so what I need is just the relationship between, so we consider two backgrounds, phi and phi plus delta phi. And remember that we had this relation that S was minus J minus NQ. So we consider the variation of this relation between the two backgrounds. So what we're getting is that they all had Xs on them. Delta S C plus minus delta J C minus B delta Q C. And now one needs, okay, actually I need this. One needs the expression for J. So you see that J had this expression in terms of the presymplectic potential and L. So I can write this as minus delta theta of delta xc phi plus c dot delta L. Okay, from here. Minus d delta xc. Now, I'm going to use the equations of motion now for both phi and phi plus delta phi. Okay. So if I do that, the on-shell vanishing Noether current and its variation is going to be zero because both backgrounds are on-shell. And then what happens is that this delta L, well, usually there was a term involved in equations of motion, which I'm dropping, is just going to be d theta of delta phi. Because the variation of the Lagrangian on shell is just a boundary term, which we define to be theta. Into C. Okay? So good. So and now I'm going to do one more thing. I'm going to add and subtract delta epsilon, sorry, delta xi of theta of delta phi. So minus delta theta of delta xi phi minus delta epsilon of theta delta phi plus xi dot d theta of delta phi minus d delta d. Okay, so I'll just add and subtract this term, formalism. The reason that I do that is because this term has a nice interpretation. This is called the presymplectic form. Omega of xi phi and phi. And if you want to understand what it is, so basically, if you just take a Lagrangian, which is just like q dot squared, so this guy is presymplectic form. Then the boundary term theta that you get when you vary the Lagrangian is something like q dot delta q, or more generally it's dl by dq dot, so this is just p delta q. Okay? And the symplectic form, okay, so I should define it, so omega of d1 phi d2 phi is d1 of theta of delta 2 phi minus d2 of theta of delta 1 phi. So this is how generally this presymplectic form is defined. So you see, if you do it in this simple example, you get that omega is precisely the p with p. So it's your usual notion of symplectic form. The reason it's called presymplectic is that here you also have to integrate it over Cauchy slice, so it's more like a local object that you then need to integrate. And then this is a system with constraints, so you have to do you have to cut out the degeneracy directions of this omega. So it's a bit more complicated, but morally speaking, it's this object. Okay, so we have this term, and then this piece here turns out that there's a general identity for forms, that the lead derivative along some vector field of some form f is the exterior derivative of c dot f plus c dot df. So this is just plug and play. And so you see from here, so this del xi is nothing but the lead derivative. So this guy is the lead derivative. So you see from this that from here one just gets minus d c dot theta of delta phi. Okay? Okay, so now we're almost done. Because what we've gotten is the following relations, that on shell we have 0 equals the presymplectic form of d xi phi and d phi plus d k xi of delta phi, where this k xi is delta q xi minus xi dot theta of delta phi. Okay, and now the point is that it's this guy that's going to give us the charge that we need to integrate over the boundary of spacetime, and that is conserved. So I should say, so I guess it was obvious from the Maxwell example that I did that we know how to compute this qxi. Qxi was just f mu. And this guy, we know how to compute it also. So this is a well-defined expression for the charge. And what's nice about it is that it is conserved because dk is 0 whenever the presymplectic form is 0. So just to give you one example, if xi is a symmetry, so xi is a killing vector, of the spacetime, then the lead derivative of phi of all the fields along C, of all the background fields along C, is going to be zero. So omega is going to be identically zero. Omega being identically zero tells you that decay is identically zero. So you just integrate your guy at infinity. It gives you a well-defined conserved charge. And not only that, because omega is zero everywhere, you don't have to integrate it only at infinity, so this is r to infinity in some spacetime of your choice, but you can integrate it over any sort of surface. You're still going to get the same result because decay is equal to zero everywhere. So this is, for example, this is the situation in electromagnetism. As long as you don't encounter charges, you can integrate your electric field over whatever surface. Okay, good. So that's one thing. However, in the general game of asymptotic symmetries, so an asymptotic symmetry is conserved but only asymptotically. So more generally, we need omega on the boundary of phi to be zero. It's sufficient to have omega on the boundary of this sigma to be zero for the charge to be conserved, because we're only integrating the charge here. So then we can only integrate it in infinity, because it's only there that is conserved. But this defines a well-defined conserved charge. And you see that it's slightly different from this Q. We need to add this additional term. OK, good. So this is the definition of the charge. Good. So now I have to tell you some properties that it has. So what this definition gives us is really what Geoffrey likes to denote by this slash delta q, which is the integral over this sigma of this kc of delta phi. So what this means is that this gives you the difference in conserved charges between two backgrounds characterized by background fields phi and phi plus phi. But and this is a well-defined conserved expression. But if you want to get a finite charge difference, like you want to know the energy of the Schwarzschild black hole, you don't want to necessarily know the difference in energy between two infinitesimally close Schwarzschild black holes. You want to know the total energy with respect to say to the vacuum. Then you sort of need to integrate discharge in field space to get from some reference background phi bar, which can be the empty space, to your background that you're interested in. And then this can be a large field excursion. So that in principle is possible. The only thing that you need to check is that the charge is integrable. Okay, sorry, I forgot to say something. So obviously what I discussed here was the conservation of the charge, which I just explained in words, that if because decay equal to zero, this guy is conserved. So now I'm going to talk about the definition of the charge. And the definition of the charge of the full finite charge with respect to for some background phi given a reference background phi tilde is just going to be the integral over some curving field space. So this curve basically just takes you from this phi bar to the phi that you're interested in. Okay? So I'm integrating infinitesimal charge differences between the different backgrounds that they get me from phi bar to phi of the integral over this sigma of xc d phi. Okay? And in principle, there can be some remainder that depends on the reference background that actually the formalism doesn't fix. So this formalism cannot fix this constant shift. You have to fix it some other way. It just gives you the charge difference between two backgrounds. Then you can assign zero charge to far value field. OK, good.
You mean a functional integral with gamma?
Yeah, so no, what I mean is that you just pick a path. So for example, So what's going to be important is that the charge doesn't depend on the path. So you pick some particular path that's convenient for you. So for example, if you want to get from flat space to the Schwarzschild black hole, you probably don't want to go through time-dependent background.
Okay.
But
you integrate over the parameters of the path.
Yeah. So for example, you can think of this as being Schwarzschild black holes of increasing mass.
Okay.
With some mass difference delta m between them, and you have to build this whole series of spacetimes and integrate it. Of course, for the Schwarzschild black hole, this is really an overkill, but there are spacetimes for which you have to do this because the falloffs are very slow. So this all makes sense, provided that the charge is integrable. So this gamma, sorry, I should say it's path in field space. And this makes sense provided that the charge satisfies integrability. Which is just the fact that if you consider, so if you try to get from point A to point B in two different ways, you first go like this and then like that, or first go like that and then like this, you should better find the same result. So mathematically, this is that the variation 1 of Q computed on delta 2 pi in pi minus delta 2 of Q then 1 pi in pi equal to 0. Okay? So this, if I first go along 1 and then along 2, or first along 2 and then along 1, I should find the same. For any delta 1, 5, delta 2. Okay, good. So this basically defines the charges. So we know how to compute them. And now I can finally tell you what an asymptotic symmetry and an asymptotic symmetry group are. So you first consider a spacetime with a set of boundary conditions. I'm going to call C. So these are boundary conditions on the metric or on whatever other fields you might have in your spacetime. So you have to specify some sort of falloff. And xi mu, so a diffeomorphism xi mu is an allowed diffeomorphism. If the lead derivative, so when you act with the lead derivative of xi on the various fields in your spacetime, metric, and so on, keeps you inside the boundary conditions. Okay. So for example, for the example that Brando was giving me before, I can take the gauge parameter to grow linearly with x, but most likely that's going to take me out of the boundary conditions that I want. Careful analysis is required in most cases. Now, it turns out that this allowed diffeomorphism satisfies an algebra given by the Lie bracket. So just, and you might have some structure constants, C ABC. Okay. And we assume that the boundary conditions are such that QC are finite, conserved, and integrable for all allowed. Okay, so this is clearly a question of boundary conditions. So you have your metric and your allowed variations of the metric and the other fields. You have the expression for the charges, so you compute the charge. If you find that the charge blows up for general metrics inside your boundary conditions, it means that your boundary conditions are too weak. So you have to make them more stringent in order to get finite charges. It's not sufficient to get finite charges. You also have to make sure that decay asymptotically goes to zero. So you also have to compute the symplectic form over there and make sure that it falls off sufficiently fast at infinity for the charge to be conserved. And finally, you have to check that your final expression for the charges is integrable, which is this condition over here. If all of those are satisfied, then you're happy. This is a consistent set of boundary conditions. Good. Now, okay, let me erase this. So now the asymptotic symmetry group.
So Monica, I have a question.
Yeah.
What would be wrong if the charges are not finite? Yeah,
well, it
you
means
often get spontaneous breaking, which is not wrong, really.
Yeah, but that's a very special. I mean, here we're talking about, say, infinite energy. If you consider a perturbation of flat space that, or say, of anti-de Sitter that has infinite energy, you probably don't consider it as being part of the same theory. Like, when you do the path integral, you have to impose boundary conditions, and the things that you're integrating are supposed to be some states. And usually states are normalizable and they have finite conserved charges. So this is why we impose finiteness.
Related comment, this integrability seems like a rather strong condition too, because you can have large gauge transformations that mix the charges in some way, and that doesn't seem so bad. So does this formula not allow that?
Integrability is needed for the charge to be well defined.
Well,
so if it's not path independent,
yeah,
then it doesn't make much sense.
But it could be well defined up to some additional discrete symmetries, which is not uncommon.
What do you mean? So here, this was an infinitesimal continuous condition,
yeah.
Right?
Right.
So you're doing some continuous deformations of your metric.
So there could be some non-trivial topology in the space of paths you take. And
okay. So that's another complication. So indeed, usually it's not the case that the space of field space is topologically not. It could happen, but yeah, most of the time we forget about it. You're right that in principle that could happen, but I again don't know of any examples.
I think there's examples, but
okay, it's probably an interesting thing to study. So I haven't studied it, but yeah, in principle that can happen if you have non-trivial topology on space, yeah. Okay, so now I'm ready to define what the asymptotic symmetry group is. So I've told you what are allowed diffeomorphisms. I also have to tell you what are trivial diffeomorphisms. Which are those xi nu such that the charges, actually it's kxi, is identically zero for any field variation. So these are diffeomorphisms. For example, if I make a diffeomorphism in the middle of the spacetime that doesn't reach up to infinity, obviously the associated charge is going to be zero because, I'm only integrating over the boundary. So diffeos for which that happens are called trivial. And the asymptotic symmetry group is simply the quotient of allowed diffeos by trivial results. And okay, so trivial defaults, they're really redundancies. I don't care about them, they're not physical. But the quotient of allowed to trivial are defaults that have, generically, they have non-trivial conserved charges, so they act non-trivially on the first space. These are actually the physical symmetries. Okay, so maybe I should end soon, but let me just say a couple more things. There's a useful representation theorem. So as I said, so these diffeomorphisms, they obey a Lie bracket algebra, which you can compute. But what you really want to know is what is going to be the algebra of the conserved charges. And this nice work of vanish front and so on proved very generally that so for this, I have to tell you what the bracket of the charges is. So if I have two charges along two diffeomorphisms, chi and xi, then the bracket is defined to be the variation with respect to xi of phi chi. Okay? So this is just the integral of d sigma of... I guess, okay, let me assume that I integrated the charges just to not to write the integrals of a gamma, but okay, you know what I mean, k chi of del c. No, actually I don't need to write it because this is infinitesimal. Okay, so this is basically the definition of the commutator of the charges, and it's been proven by these guys that actually this is the charge along the Lie bracket of the fields plus an eventual central extension, which depends on the values of the fields on the background. So this is a central charge. So this is called the representation theorem, and it's very useful because it tells you you don't have to plug in all your generic form of the asymptotic fields and actually compute all of this. You know a priori that the algebra that you're going to get is just going to be the Lie bracket algebra of your fields up to some central term that you can compute very easily. So that's sort of nice. So for example, in the case of ADS3, what you get is that this guy is going to give you the width part of the algebra. And the central extension of the Virasoro is going to come from this term. Another thing I should say, maybe it's too technical, is that this bracket is actually modified. If you have field-dependent diffeomorphisms in some nasty spacetimes, you can. Then you have to modify this bracket, but it's not how to do it. And these guys are really, it's a very powerful formalism. So they know how to do all this. Okay. Then there are some residual ambiguities, which you can read about in, I guess, Wald. Okay, should I spend my time on this? Maybe very briefly. When am I supposed to end?
You can take 10 more minutes.
No, I don't need 10 more minutes. It's just a... Okay, I just say this to be complete. It's not super necessary, but okay. So you have some ambiguities. For example, you could add a total derivative to Lagrangian. So this shifts theta by, which depending on delta phi, by delta mu, and then you can see how it propagates into the expression for the charges, and my conclusion is that actually it doesn't affect the charges. You can also add, so since theta is only defined by L goes to equations of motion plus d theta, in principle I can add to theta d of something, and I wouldn't see it from this equation, so I call that thing y. And this will show up in the charges. So there's a little bit of ambiguity in them, but sometimes you can exploit this ambiguity to construct charges that are nicer behaved, for example. But there's it's all been classified. And then finally, I had an example. Okay, so I'll just give you the formula for Einstein gravity and write down a couple of exercises, and then I'll be done. So just let me show you, just flash to you what the charge looks like for GR. I mean, this is just algebra in the end. You plug it in and you do it, and that's it. So, okay, so for general relativity, so 1 over 16 pi g integral of r square root of g. Then it turns out, so I switch back to index notation, which is more useful when you write down actual formula. So theta mu is square root of g over 16. So theta mu is a function of d phi. And for the metric, I'm going to call define h mu mu, the metric perturbation. So you get something like d mu h mu mu minus d mu h. So this is the boundary term that you get when you do the variation of the Einstein action to obtain the Einstein equations of motion. You pick up some boundary term, which is this. This is when you try to derive g mu mu equal to 0 just from the action. Okay, and then j mu, remember, was theta mu of the xi phi minus xi dot n. Okay, so now I have to be careful. So this now L is back to being a scalar, and xi dot L just multiplies it by the vector xi mu, going back from the form notation. And so this guy is just the lead derivative of g mu mu, which is d mu xi mu plus d mu xi mu. And so you're going to get something like square root of g 16 pi g. I think all this is done very carefully and explicitly in Geoffrey's notes. So, I mean, this is just for exemplification. Xi mu minus twice d mu xi mu. Okay. So here, this is just the h mu mu term that's over here, and twice this guy is h, because when I contact this with the metric, I pick twice d mu xi mu. So this is this term. And then I can, I can switch around these two derivatives. And switching them around, so in principle, I pick up a factor of this. So when I try to invert this derivative, I pick something like r mu mu xi mu. What am I doing? Right? The commutator of the derivatives is it gives me a factor of the Riemann tensor. But here the Riemann tensor is contracted, nu with nu. So I'm picking just the Ricci tensor. But since I'm in vacuum general relativity, the Ricci tensor is 0. So I can just switch these guys by themselves. So what I get is square root of g of 16 pi g d nu of, so now I have this guy minus twice itself, so it's going to come with a minus sign, so I just write d nu xi mu minus d nu xi mu. Okay, so this term in parentheses with this extra prefactor factor is supposed to be just the q mu nu that we were talking about before. And actually, If you just integrate Q mu nu over the boundary of spacetime, you notice that this is nothing but the Pomade expression for conserved charge. So you might remember from your general relativity book that one way to compute, for example, the mass and the angular momentum of say the Kerr black hole, so it holds for spacetimes with a Killing symmetry. So if you want to compute the mass, you take C equals d by dt. You compute this integral over the boundary of the spacetime of a Kerr black hole, and what you find is the mass of the Kerr black hole. Take C equals d phi, and what this expression will compute for you is the angular momentum of the Kerr black hole. So this is a known expression from long time ago for how to compute conserved charges for spacetime with Killing vectors. Okay, but we're doing something fancier. Okay, so actually one of the exercises was to compute MJ for curve using the command expression, which is just integrating this over the boundary of the spacetime. Or if not, you can look it up. I think Sean Carroll does it. So. Okay? But what we want to do is do this more fancy expression where you compute this kxc, which was delta qc minus c dot delta theta. And the expression that you get for that, assuming that I can, let me try to write it here. It's going to be square root of g over 8 pi newton times c mu d sigma h. So what you need to do is very clear. You take this expression for q, you vary it with respect to an arbitrary variation of the metric. It's going to pop out a lot of ugly terms. And then you take that expression for theta, which is it's already delta theta, right? Sorry, I mean it's theta of delta phi. And then you put it in, and then it gives you some expression for this infinitesimal charge difference C. And as you see, it's very ugly. H plus. You don't need to really copy it. The only reason I'm writing it is actually there's a typo in Geoffrey's notes. He has the same index here, so that's all. But apart from that, you can find it all over the literature. And d nu h nu sigma plus a half h d nu xi mu minus h rho mu 0 xi mu. And then if you want to compute the charge, you have to dot this into the epsilon tensor and integrate it over the boundary of the space. Okay? So you see, it's kind of an ugly expression. This sort of expression is a lot more simple to understand, but this is what you get. And this expression, you use it for... So what are you supposed to do with it? Now I have to give you the boundary condition, tell you how things fall off at the asymptotic fall-off of the space-time, and you just plug this fall-off into Mathematica, use Mathematica to compute this expression and see if things are finite, and blah, blah. And then you compute the symplectic forms, if it's finite asymptotically and so on, and this gives you the expression for the charges. And basically the nice thing about it is that it works for really a lot of space-time with very weird asymptotics. Okay, so now you know how it's derived, but from now on, if you ever want to use it, you just look it up and plug it into Mathematica. That's all about it. So I guess what I'm going to do in the next lecture, so given that I've really killed you with this formalism, I wanted to show you that it's actually useful for something. So one thing that I'm going to discuss is how to get a one-line derivation of the first law of black hole mechanics using this formalism, which also gives a nice interpretation of the black hole entropy as neutral charge associated to the translations along the generator of the horizon. And depending on how much it would take me to introduce stuff, so I decide I could also talk about this converse of deriving Einstein's equation from the first law, which should be interesting. Okay, so, and I had one more exercise, use this ugly expression to compute the Schwarzschild mass. The mass. So as I was telling Ricardo earlier, this only gives you the charge difference, so you have to consider a series of Schwarzschild black holes that differ by little delta m. You compute the infinitesimal charge difference between each of them using this ugly expression. Most of the homework is to how to plug this into Mathematica. And then you integrate, the integration is trivial. Okay, so that's all for today.